please join us for a time of fellowship outside on Pierce Lawn, courtesy of Fellowship and Friends. You are also welcome to join our Zoom coffee hour a little bit later on, hosted by Arlene at 11:30. And the meeting code can be found in this morning's bulletin. Join us on Pierce Lawn for a wine and craft beer tasting next Saturday night, September 26th, from 4 to 7. Please bring your own appetizer, not to be shared this year, and a wine glass. We're asking for a suggested donation of $20. The proceeds will be split between Nourish Bridgeport, which is a feeding program run out of the United Congregational Church, and also the Geraldine Johnson Elementary School in Bridgeport. We're going to help fund some health and wellness supplies for the students there. Then next Sunday, the 27th, from 2 to 4, the Monroe Playground Foundation is holding an ice cream social fundraiser on the green. Bring a picnic basket or blanket or chair, or you can drive through the takeout. Masks and social distancing rules are in effect. The rain date is October 4th. Now, this year's crop walk has been rescheduled from last spring, and it will be virtual. Our own Julie McClendon is our coordinator for the walk, so she's going to please come up and tell us a little bit more.
CROP is the community appeal of Church World Service. It fights hunger locally, nationally, and internationally, and emphasizes self-sustaining agricultural practices. 75% of the money raised will be used by CWS. And 25% stays in the greater Bridgeport area. I am your Crop Walk coordinator for 2020. This year, Church World Service has decided to organize a virtual walk, meaning we will walk in our own towns and gather donations in person and online. If you would like to help our neighbors in the wider world, please see me outside at coffee hour, pick up an envelope and get sponsors, or share a bit of what you have by making a contribution to CWS Crop. I have also posted a link on the MCC Facebook page.
Thank you so much, Julie, for that, for your service. Are there any other announcements to be shared today? Yes, Peggy.
Could be mustard seed theory today. That's the theory today. Be socially distanced on the brick on Pierce Lawn for just a couple minutes after church.
Wonderful. That's just the steering committee for the mustard seed. Join outside on Pierce Lawn. Thank you so much. Well, friends, come, let us worship.
Please join me in the call to worship as printed in your bulletin. Come, the God of every blessing calls us to worship.
We offer God our thanks and praise.
Come, the God who longs for relationship calls us to worship.
We bring our whole selves, trusting and doubting, to meet the living God.
Come, the God who is faithful to every promise calls us to worship.
We trust God's goodness and seek to be faithful in return.
Come, let us worship God together. Please pray with me. God, some of us are shivering, and we're a little disoriented by all the blue tape in the pews and on the floor, and we still have trouble getting used to wearing these masks and seeing each other with a masked face. But we are so grateful to be here today. We are so grateful to be in each other's presence, to be once again in our beloved meeting house. And we offer you our deepest thanks for this opportunity. We have been separated for such a long time. We've had a glimpse of what our past experience of a worshiping community has been like over the summer outside. And now, as we take one more step back to the familiar, we are grateful. And we come before you today with gratitude and love in our hearts for how you have carried us to this point, how you have reminded us of the importance of the bonds that exist between us. And we pray that you would be with us now, and including those who are watching from home, that you would continue to bring us to the knowledge of your love, the knowledge that we are one body, and that you call us to love each other unconditionally. Thank you once again, and be with us in our worship today, we pray. Amen. And now, would you please stand and join with me as we read together our church's covenant. We declare our faith in God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In holy covenant, we bind ourselves to God and each other, becoming devoted disciples and active apostles. We promise each other to be faithful in worship and in support of this church, whose Savior and Lord is Jesus Christ. In Christian love, we will care for and support each other. With the Bible as our guide, we willingly promise all that we are and all that we have to the fulfillment of God's kingdom. Freely we say these things, glorying in the joy of our salvation. And now, from a distance, as has become our custom, our temporary custom, let us share with one another a sign of God's peace. Peace be with you.
Joys.
daughter's operation tomorrow, we hold her in our hearts for speedy healing, good results. Joyce.
Strength and healing for Chris and Carol.
For Chris and Carol, strength and healing. Thank you. Anne.
Healing for Gerald, Roberta, and Cindy.
Gerald, Roberta, and Cindy. God's peace and healing, we pray. Jen.
Comfort for many on the loss of his best friend. And just like, I'd like to have some hope around here. Because I feel this is I'm feeling a little bit of a need.
Feeling a need for hope. Amen. And we pray for many. Thank you. Yes.
Prayers for Fran.
For Fran, we pray. Friends, let us hold these concerns and joys in our hearts now in a time of silent prayer before God. Holy One, you are the God who protects, the one who gives, the Messiah who promises. We come looking for your protection for the earth and the seas and the skies. We lift our eyes to the stars and we pray for your blessed creation and all who dwell and depend upon it. May we treat this world as a blessing. We join our voices with our ancestors in the faith, asking for your gifts of healing for those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. For peace for those who live in the midst of violence. For hope for those who cannot see past the shadows. For nourishment for those who are hungry. We lift our eyes to the stars and we pray for our neighbors near and far. May they experience your abundant love. We look to your promises. We pray for the grace and the courage to trust. Make our lives an image of your love. Guide us to act on your call to reach out with compassion, to offer your care even when we don't fully understand, to make your kingdom of peace visible here and now. We lift our eyes to the stars and we pray to see your vision. May we be faithful to your way. We bring these prayers to you, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, as we pray together with one voice, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
Friends, when our eyes are heavy, we dream of another world. When our spirits are low, we turn to each other. When our anger flares, we need one another's love the most. We give our gifts of tithes and offerings to renew the world again. Our offering plate may be found on the hospitality table as you leave worship today. You may also choose to give online at www.mcc-ucc/donate. Thank you for keeping this church family in your heart's giving. We bring our offerings, the fruit of our labor, as a sign of our deep gratitude. As we return our gifts to God, we pray they are multiplied into a blessing for the world. In Christ's name. Thank you.
lesson today is Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 6. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look towards heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. Then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. May God add a blessing to our reading of this holy word.
Thank you so much, John. So we left the story last week with God expelling Adam and Eve from the garden after they had reached beyond their God-given limitations. So over the following centuries, we're told that humans are seeking more and more of their own way, rejecting God's wisdom over and over again. God even tries to do a global reboot with an ark and a covenant and animals two by two, but the result is the same. These people that were created from dust, who carry the very breath of God in their lungs, continue to wander further and further away from the place and the purpose they were created for. How frustrating. So the Creator God changes strategy. Instead of working with all humanity, God chooses one family through whom the connection might be reestablished, a man and woman, and eventually another woman, whom he can walk with once again. And through this one family, God plans to bless them all. And so God calls a man named Abram to leave all he has behind from his homeland of Ur and follow where God will lead. And Abram does, but the way is not easy, nor is the path clear, and he keeps getting himself in all kinds of messes. And there's famine in the land, so Abram heads to Egypt, where he deceives Pharaoh about Sarai, his wife, to protect his own skin. And when he returns, he encounters conflict with those around him. His nephew Lot is kidnapped, but later rescued. By the time our story today takes place, Abram has become a rather wealthy man. And yet, there is something that is still troubling him, worries that are still on his mind. The God of Abraham makes some pretty big promises. Land. Countless faithful descendants who will be a blessing to all the nations of the world, just to name the two most important ones. But what happens when those dreams are delayed? No kids, no land, just a vague promise in your back pocket, an empty heartache. And that's why Abraham is so disappointed looking out there at the night sky. We know what that feels like. When we're afraid and we're sad, because it feels like everything that has been promised to us is late. As the great Tom Petty was known to sing, the waiting is the hardest part. Our first instinct as human beings, of course, is to take matters into our own hands or to settle for something less and seek an alternative future. So Abraham resigns himself that his slave, Eliezer, will be the one who will eventually inherit his worldly goods. Not that there's anything wrong with that. I'm sure good old Eli is a trusted member of the staff. Abraham just wishes he could keep it all in the family. Then Sarah arranges to become a mother via a surrogate arrangement with her slave, Hagar. Perhaps being righteous has nothing to do with a lack of virtue or morality, but everything to do with how we handle promises and trust. Do we do it the right way? Trusting in the promises of God, accepting the outcome of the moment, or do we take a shortcut and hope for the best? I can relate to wanting to find a shortcut right now. Like many of you, I'm tired of making decisions about everyday things that shouldn't be a big deal. It's like there's this big phantom menace out there, for you Star Wars fans. You know, it's forcing me to make hard choices where everything is a balance of risk and reward. Every decision that we make seems like a life and death one. And the pressure is weighing on all of us in one manner or another. It's called decision fatigue, and it is heavy, my friends. But the truth is that we can't skip ahead any more than Abraham could. The facts on the ground after that starry, starry night remained unchanged. Still no kid, still no land, just more waiting. No proof either, or even signs really. Just a Bedouin longing for a better future. We see the same scene around the world every day. And yet, God does not shame Abraham for his questioning, nor rebuke his anger. God simply calls him forth from the confines of his tent to look at the wide and sparkling sky above. And God waits patiently as he counts each twinkle. And when he eventually loses track and he gives up counting, God renews the promise, "So shall your descendants be." It's Abraham's choice to accept the promise that God has in store. And the choice he makes is not about maintaining his own power, it's about taking responsibility, which is the beginning of covenant. God's challenge to count the stars is not an exercise in science or math, although some have tried it. 70 sextillion, that's a 7 followed by 22 zeros, is the latest count, according to the stargazers at the Australian National University. They claim that this is 10 times as many stars as there are grains of sand on all the world's beaches and deserts. And Aussies should know they have plenty of both, right? Abraham's faith is renewed because God opens space for his grief. As he attempts this impossible counting of stars, then he speaks the promise again when Abraham has nothing left to say. The text calls this moment righteousness. In Hebrew, tzedakah, which might be better translated as being in healthy, right relationship. And whether that is because Abraham has believed God's word, or that God has listened to Abraham, that he has held and honored an old man's grief, that's yet to be determined. Both God and Abraham have done right by each other. What a brilliant preview of what Abrahamic promise trusters will come to be. A light that shines in the darkness. Repeated in the sacred text as Christ's charge to all who follow him, "Let your light so shine before others, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." So when promise trusters like you and me do our job and we give witness to that light, we become lights through words and song, sacramental acts and care and service, even when our usual ways of doing so get disrupted and we struggle. And that completes the promise. Not just the one be fulfilled in God's own time. And when we get anxious, we too can go out and look at the sky and remember where to place our trust. Amen. As our worship concludes here today, we go out into the world to live, to love, and to serve. We carry with us our hopes for the future, but also our grief for that which we have lost. In the midst of hope and fear and grief and possibilities, we will meet God, the one who continues to sustain us and guide us by the light of the stars. Go now in peace.